الله أكبر
الحمد لله الذي بنعمته تتم الصالحات وهو الذي يقبل التوبة عن عباده ويعفو عن السيئات غافل الذنب وقابل التوب شديد العقاب للطول لا إله إلا هو إليه المصير والمآب. الحمد لله على إحسانه والشكر له على توفيقه وامتنانه وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله تعظيما لشأنه وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله الداعي إلى رضوانه صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وإخوانه وخلانه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، يقول الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد بعد أن أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى فإن الجنة هي المأوى. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: الكيس من دان نفسه وعامل لما بعد الموت، والعاجز من أتبع نفسه هواه وتمنى على الله الأماني. أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين. All praise, thanks and glory belongs to Allah alone. He is independent, He is the sustainer of the entire universe. We also bear witness and testify that Muhammad the son of Abdullah is the last and final messenger of Allah. May peace, blessings and salutations be upon him, his family, his noble companions, and all those who follow his footsteps until the day of judgment. We respect elders and brothers, mothers and sisters. Whenever a good thing would come to an end, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Alhamdulillahi alladhi bi ni'matihi tatimmu as-salihat. All praise is due to Allah, by whose blessings all good things come to an end. And we have just witnessed the end of the most blessed month of Ramadan come to an end. So for that, we're all grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam al-Shafi'i said, if you are able to worship Allah ta'ala, then for that worship, give thanks to Allah azza wa ta'ala, because He is the one that enabled you to do that in the first place. It's only been 2 weeks from Ramadan, and it's a good time right now for us to ask ourselves this very potent and important questions that scholars ask themselves after the month of Ramadan comes to an end. And that question is, if Ramadan has left, have we left Ramadan after 2 weeks? How much connection we have still with Ramadan? Ramadan, in a sense, is just like any other time in the common, the universe that Allah Azza wa Jalla has created. Night is going to come, and the day is going to follow, day is going to come, night is going to follow. Similarly, Ramadan is going to come, Eid is going to come, the year is going to end, next year is going to come. So Ramadan has to leave. It's not going to stay for anyone. But have we also left Ramadan the things that we used to do in Ramadan? The salah, the qiyam, the tazkir, the tasbih, and all the other things that we used to do. How much of that have we retained with ourselves after the passing of Ramadan? You know, they say that حَاسِمُوا قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Hold yourself accountable before you are held accountable. Hold yourself accountable. What have you been doing for the past 2 weeks after Ramadan is finished? Now the point is not that we're going to be able to all do the same exact things we did in Ramadan. It's not possible. It's not possible every night for every single one of us to do 20 rak'at of tarawih. But Ramadan came and showed us what we are capable of. We were able to discover how much power and spiritual strength we have in order to carry out these actions of ibadat. You know, sometimes you might think we're not able to do. Now you think about 2 rak'ah every night, you'll be like, I won't be able to do it. In Ramadan, we were able to do it. We have that strength. So Ramadan came to teach us that we have that power to actually subdue and suppress and take hold of our nafs. Nafs always stays with us. Shaitan, he goes away in Ramadan. But say, nafs is always there. Nafs is something that's very natural. One Sahabi, he came to the Prophet and said, Ya Rasulullah, he complained about his nafs, some issues he was having with the nafs. The Prophet, he placed his hand on the chest of the Sahabi and he said, Allahumma tahhir qalba, Ya Allah, clean and purify his heart. Waghfir dhanba, forgive his sins. Wahassin faraja, and keep him modest and chaste, and keep let him have haya, a good, a shameful, bashful life. Meaning, nafs is something that every single person has. So now that we are back after Allah, nafs is still with us. We have to learn to live with nafs as something natural. But if we remind ourselves of the harms that following nafs comes with, maybe for the rest of the year, we might be able to stay away a little bit from this nafs.
in the month of Ramadan, one person who was saying that when the month of Ramadan came, he got into a very good diet of eating healthy food. And then when the day of Eid came, he said, it's the day of Eid, these are the days of eating and enjoying with family. So he started eating some unhealthy food. And then those couple of days turned into a week. Those weeks turned into months. And then those months turned into years. And before this Ramadan, he said he found himself in a compromising situation with his health and the image of his body. Because he did not hold himself accountable within those first days. So now that we're still in those first weeks of Ramadan, let us remind ourselves that not to go too far away from what we are doing in Ramadan. Because by the end of the year, Allah knows who we will be if we don't hold ourselves accountable from now. So what is the first and the most biggest harm that comes our way when we follow our nafs? The first thing that happens is that happiness leaves us. We don't have the peace of mind. For the moment when we follow the nafs, there will be a buzz, there will be some energy, there will be some ecstasy, you will have a good feeling, whatever it might be. But after that comes to an end, there's no peace in your heart. Ask yourself, they say following the nafs is like a fruit. حَلَوَتُهَا تَفْنَى. The sweetness of that fruit finishes quickly. But مَرَارَتُهَا تَبْقَى. Its bitterness stays with you for days to come. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, his son, one day he saw his son wearing some clothes that wasn't befitting him. He was ripped and had patches on him, etc. So Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, he was teared up a little bit. I'm the father, I'm supposed to provide for my son, he doesn't have good clothing. So he's about to cry. And the son, he said, Ma yubkiyik, oh my father, what makes you cry? Why are you crying on this day of Eid? He said, أَخْشَىٰ أَن يَنْكَسِرَ قَلْبُكَ يَوْمَ الْعِيدِ إِذْ رَأَتَ الصُّبْيَانُ بِهَذَا الْقَمِيصُ الْخَلِقِ. He said that I fear that the kids of the neighborhood, they will laugh at you and you will be sad on this day. Your heart will be broken, you will be depressed, you won't have a peace of mind on this day. So this child, back in the days, children weren't the same as now. They're very mature, they're very understanding, they're very conscious of their surroundings. Even in pre-modern Europe, they used to treat children like adults. They used to dress them up like that, give them big responsibilities. Nowadays, we have spoiled our children. There was one child who was sitting in the kitchen with his mother. And the mother, she started the fire with small pieces of wood. She was putting that in the fire first. And the child started crying. The mother said, why are you crying? He said, that you're starting the fire with the small little pieces of wood first. I fear that Allah will start the fire in Jahannam with the young people who disobey him. So they're very conscious. They're like the children of nowadays. So he said, oh my father, what makes you cry? He said, this is the reason. He says, إِنَّمَا يَنْكَسِنُ قَلْبُ مَنْ أَعْدَمَهُ اللَّهُ لِلَّهُ. My father, you have nothing to worry about. I am not sad. The person who's actually really sad is the person who Allah deprived him of his happiness because he sinned against Allah Azza wa Jal. The person when he sins, he has no peace after that. Maybe for the moment you will have tranquility and peace, whatever it might be. But after that, for the long term, there's no peace. Ibn Qudamah, he mentioned in his book Kitab al-Tawwabin, there's a man named Mahdi, and he used to do all the sins and follow his nafs, and anything you can think of, he did all of those things. One day his slave girl, she came and she brought a charcoal that had fire on it, and she put it on his foot. And he woke up, what are you doing? You crazy? Why are you putting fire on my foot? She said, جَمْرَةٌ مِنْ نَارِ الدُّنْيَا فَكَيْفَ تَصْنَعُ مِنْ نَارِ الْآخِرَةِ. This is just a charcoal of this world. What are you going to do with the fire of Jahannam? Wake up, change your life, change your route. So this person, he changed his way. And then later on, two scholars came to him, Khalid ibn Ayyad and Sufyan al-Thawri. They came to Mahdi and said, Mahdi, you left the life of following your nafs and desire and jahawat. You left that life and became obedient servant of Allah Azza wa Jalla. What did Allah give you in return? He said, Ar-ridha bima ana fihi. The peace of mind, the happiness that I am in, this is what I got in return. Before, I lived a fun life, but there was no peace in my life. Now, I live an obedient life and a humble life, but I have peace and tranquility in my life. So this is one thing we can remind ourselves, our respected elders and brothers and mothers and sisters, that in the month of Ramadan, we saw what we're powerful, we saw what we're capable of, we have strength, we can do the things that we think we cannot do. Let us keep that momentum and that strength, keep going until the next Ramadan comes. And Allah Azza wa Jalla give us, me and all of you, the tawfiq to follow whatever has been said. I
these items we must go through with the Lord for. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي ساعة من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعص الله ورسوله فقد ضل ضلالا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Respected elders and brothers, if you look into the lives of the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam, you'll find many examples of even the prophets alayhim salatu wasalam when they suppressed their nasr, Allah gave them back in return. You sacrifice something for the sake of Allah, Allah will give you something 10 times better than that. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, when he was offered by the wife of the minister, and he put his nafs down, Allah azza wa jalla gave him what in return? He made him the minister of finance in Egypt. Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam, it was mentioned that at the time of Asr, he was inspecting his horses. And because he got busy with that, he became very late for one of his salah. And then he said, I will slaughter all of these horses because they made me late for my salah. And then what did Allah Azza wa Jalla give him back in return? When he said, Allah gave him back the wind, power over the wind. He used to travel the distance of a month in one morning and the distance of another month in the afternoon. And one time Abu Talib, the uncle of the Prophet, came and said, O Muhammad, I only see that your Lord obeys you. Whatever you ask, dua, Allah gives you right back in return. So he said, وَأَنْتَ يَا عَمَّ أَطَعْتَ رَبِّي لَأَطَعْتَ. Oh my uncle, if you do the same, Allah will do the same for you. It's not only for the prophets and the anbiya. The Prophet ﷺ said, a man who is very normal, who will have good clothes, he will have dirty hair, you will think he's nobody. But لَوْ أَقْسَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ لَأَبَرَّ. If he makes an oath by Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will fulfill that oath. Brothers, where do you think that strength comes from? That strength comes from suppressing our nafs and giving up something for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. You give up something for the sake of Allah and you see that your prayers being answered immediately. Allah Azza wa Jal gives us all the tawfiq. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-kayyisu man dana nafsahu wa amina lima ba'da al-maut wal-ajizu man atba'a nafsahu hawa wa tamanna ala al-qamiri. He said that the intelligent person, al-kayyis, the intelligent person is man dana nafsa, who puts his nafs down, who says no to his nafs, وَعَمِلَ لِمَا بَعْدَ الْمَوْتِ, and he works for the hereafter. He doesn't work only for this world, he works for the hereafter. وَالْعَادِزُ مَنْ أَتْبَعَ نَفْسَ الْخَوَاهَا, and the weak person is the one that who follows his desires and his nafs, تَمَنَّا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْمَالِ, and he just has false hopes in Allah. He said, Allah, continues to follow his nafs. Allah Azza wa Jalla make us all of the people whom the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam described as intelligent. Allah Azza wa Jalla give us all the fear of Allah Azza wa Jalla so that we can put down our nafs and we can make Jannah our final abode. Ameen. Rabbana zalamna anfusana wa in lam taghfir lana wa tarhamna lanakunanna min al-khasirin. Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanatan wa fil akhirati hasanatan wa qina adhab an-nar. Allahumma a'izz al-Islam wal muslimin. Allahumma ansur Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وجعلنا منهم عباد الله رحمكم الله ان الله يامر بالعدل والاحسان وايتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله الجليل يذكركم وذكر الله تعالى اولى واعلى واجل واتم واكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون. اقيموا الصلاه.